Cecilia Lynch, and I'm professor of political science and director of the Institute for International, Global, and Regional Studies here at the University of California, Irvine. And it's my distinct pleasure to welcome you, members of the campus and the community, this evening to a talk by Professor Vivian Antunes-Saiz of the University of Havana on empowering women in Cuba. I have to say it's a good day when we can celebrate the normalization of U.S.-Cuban relations in such style. I want to thank all of the organizations and people who made this possible. First of all, Professor John Whiteley and Professor William Hernandez, the Newkirk Center for Science and Society, the Center for Global Leadership of the Mirage School of Business, the Empowering Sustainability Initiative of the School of Social Ecology, and also the institute that I direct. And I'll tell you a little bit about IGARS, the Institute for International, Global, and Regional Studies. We're a relatively new thing on campus. We're a research network that is associated, that grew out of the International Studies undergraduate program. And we're housed in the School of Social Sciences, but we reach out across campus to cultivate connections among the wide, wide array of UCI centers, institutes, and departments with research interests that traverse, that cross boundaries, that cross geographical, political, and disciplinary boundaries. We try to bring together and create synergies among the numerous faculty in social sciences, humanities, social ecology, business, the arts, public health, law, medicine, et cetera, across campus to think about how our work, which we often conduct in our disciplinary silos, might intersect. And tonight, I think this is a wonderful example of crossing silos among the schools of social ecology, business, and social sciences. It's also my pleasure to introduce Professor William Hernandez, who will then introduce our speaker. Professor Hernandez is an indefatigable organizer and entrepreneur and UCI booster, whom I have had the pleasure to know now for a couple of years. He makes events like this possible, and so does Professor Whiteley. Professor Hernandez is a JD from Georgetown, and before that, he received his BA in political science from the University of California, Irvine, which is one of the reasons why he spends so much of his time giving back to our community. He's a specialist in both international business, trade, and law. He's taught some wonderful classes for us in international studies, I'm very proud to say. And he is also the incoming director, executive director of the new Center for Global Leadership in the Paul Mirage School of Business. So please join me in welcoming Professor Hernandez.
Welcome. What we have here in front of us is perhaps one of the telltale marks of something that happened on December 17th last year. On that day, President Barack Obama and President Raul Castro made a statement to the world that the normalization of relations was about to begin, that the 50 plus years of separation between the two countries was about to end, and what we have before us is nothing less than the implementation of what many times appears to be a shallow, insignificant commentary by one of our presidents. And yet, in fact, it is being carried out. I have the distinct honor of being involved from a very early stage precisely with that normalization process. And it was precisely through the vision of Professor Whiteley and a large group of people, including Professor Lynch, that we had for the opportunity to bring about truly a distinct situation. I begin also by saying that I have the distinct honor and privilege of serving as the executive director for the Center for Global Leadership out of the Paul Mirage School of Business. Although it happens to be a relatively new center, I encourage each and every one of you to begin to look at it for precisely what it seeks to do. We at the center, and with your help and collaboration, hope to have the beginnings here at UCI of truly innovative leadership capabilities, the type of leadership that hopefully will lead towards what my great colleague, Professor John Graham, as a co-director of the center from the faculty side, is going to bring about as what we engender as peace through trade. If you'll allow me just a couple of seconds, what we seek to do at the center is literally engender peace. We believe that by people interacting with other people, they will in turn seek to avoid any potential violent conflict. The more we seek to interact with each other, to be able to trade with each other, when I am dependent upon you and you are dependent upon me, the likelihood of violent dispute will lessen. In that capacity, we hope to be able to count on each and every one in this room to bring that about, and we encourage you and ask that you would seek to participate in some of the wonderful things that are beginning to happen here at UCI through the various programs that you've begun to hear, and you are most certainly one of them. That being said, I have the distinct pleasure of introducing to you Vivian Antunes Seiss. Sometimes it's best to put this within what I would describe as a personal anecdote. Let me put it very succinctly. Doing business, interacting with Cubans is not a simple endeavor. It is fraught with what many of you have sensed and experienced, perhaps, as fraught with just a whole host of complexities. When I first met Vivian, it was immediately 2 or 3 days after the normalization process. It is by means of personal interrelationships. And let me stop there for a second and harbor on precisely that point. There is no such thing as international work. That does not exist. There is only interpersonal work done internationally. And it is through a series of friends, colleagues, people that we know and trust, that we were blessed to be in a situation where we met with Vivian. And in that very first moment, in el Hotel Nacional in Havana, I met with her. And what I discovered is really what many people are discovering in the Pearl of the Antilles. It is, in fact, an amazing change from what is happening in many other countries on Earth. The concept of an emerging market is a concept that is radically changing, and I believe that Cuba is at the forefront of that. And in that very first meeting when we met, we went through the niceties, the means by which we engage in meaningful banter in order to be able to determine whether or not this was going to be a fit. Not only was it a fit, but it was a projection towards the future. I have the distinct pleasure of presenting to you today Vivian Antunes, which is really a representative of precisely that vision, women being empowered in Cuba and the role that they will play in this updating of the reality that we all know is happening. So without further ado, I ask you to join me, please, in a round of applause for Vivian Antunes.
Good evening to you all. Cuba is unique in many aspects. This uniqueness is reflected in terms of politics, culture, social, as well as its history. And my name is Vivian Antunes. I work as a professor at the University of Havana. And in this evening, I'm going to illustrate the important role that played the woman in the Cuban society. This presentation is organized in three parts. As first, I will talk about the general characterization of Cuba. As second, the national context of updating our economic and political model. And as third, the participation of women in the Cuban society. Many countries whose people, culture, and cultures derive from diverse origins, including Aboriginal, Spanish colonization, the introduction of African slaves, so we are a mixture. As you can see here, this is the new political administrative division of Cuba. Cuba is located in the Caribbean, comprising the main island of Cuba and several archipelagos. It's the largest island of the Caribbean, with over 11 million of population. Cuba is a multi. As you can see here, we have an area of 109,000 square kilometers. The population is around 11 million of people. Cuba is composed of 15 provinces and a special municipality. The capital city is Havana, and the official language is Spanish. Cuba is very ranked in human development by the United Nations and very ranked for health and education too. Although my country is economically underdeveloped, its social, economic, demographic indicators similar to developed countries. As you can see here, the Human Development Index is 0.77. The life expectancy of birth is 79 years old. The infant mortality rate in children under 5 years is 4.2 per 1,000 born alive. So we are ranked very high for human development in my country. Also, Cuba is passing through the updating of its economic model with the appliance of the guidelines. We are working to eliminating the low flexibility of the planning process, working to introduce market techniques, planning tools. We are working in development many experiments with the separation among the state function and the enterprise function, looking forward to more autonomy, more self-determination by local governments, more development of the private sector, promoting the increase of the creation of non-agriculture cooperatives. We're working also to the organization and updating of legal standards and requirements. So in all of this process, the Cuban woman plays an important role. Related to the international context to woman participation, according to the International Labor Organization, Latin America shows in 2007 increase of the participation of women in the labor force from 47% to 52% in 2010. The second highest of the world. The service sector count with 74% of women. However, a lot of these employees are in informal sectors and vulnerable jobs. Cuba has a total different situation. After the revolution triumph in 1959, the women were incorporated in all process of change that occurs in those years. Women have the same constitutional rights as men. Free access to all level to education, access to quality child care, health care. We enjoy the same opportunity for works, equal pay of salary for men and women in the same position. The creation of the Cuban Women Federation in 1960 was a key initiative to implement a set of different courses in order to provide women abilities to work, to prepare them for the labor market, language course, technical course. This, the Cuban Women Federation was a non-governmental organization, has legislative power in the national context, and have 4 million women members of over 14 years, represent the 90% of all Cuban women in the country. The educational campaign in 1961 provided with free educational services to all the Cuban people. The women had full access to all educational levels, including the polytechnical and the university school. Also, the women played an important role in this process as teachers in many Cuban provinces. In the 60s and in the 70s, we approved a set of law for women in order to provide them access to employment, such the work code that I worked before, family code. The maternity law helps the women workers in the point of view establish the wages, Since the 7th month of pregnancy up to a year after they gave birth, they receive a completed salary and also maintain the work. The family also can obtain this type of license, the maternity law, security and health law, social and security and penal code. As you can see here in this graph, the woman graduating from superior education from the university represent in 2007 the 65%, and the executive woman in position represent the 38%. Also, the professional and technical expert represent the 65%. This statistic has increased, has evolved. As you can see here, in 2013, the woman represent in the executive position the 45% of the woman in the country, 66% representing professional and technical experts, and graduating in superior education, 65%. Also in 2014, this statistic has increased. As you can see here, the executive woman was represented the 47%. And the political life, participation in political life. As you can see here, the 48% of the parliamentary seats represents the deputy to the National Assembly. So we have a very political life, active in political life. As you can see here, the 37% of women represent the active economic population. And they graduated for superior education. These numbers are for 2013, represent the 60% of women graduated for the universities in Cuba. And you can see also the different fields. 45% were graduated for medical science, 21% social science, 11% economic science, 5%, 6% technical science. Also, the Cuban women have an important participation in different national ministries. As you can see here, the vice president of the Council of the State, the Comptroller, is a woman. Also, the Ministry of Education is a woman too, the Finance and Price, Justice, Labor and Social Security, Science, Technology and the Environment have a very important positions and represented by women. Which are the challenges that face a woman in the Cuban society? Well, continue to improve the study plans and program, textbooks and other educational material and mass media program, in raising awareness about gender equality, education and training based on the solid ethical, moral principles and values in the family and in the school. Continue to develop activities that make it possible to systematize, extend, and recognize the role of women in science and innovation. Make it possible to incorporate demographic, sex, and race variables in the continuous and special statistics collected and to apply sustainable methodology in order to obtain a gender analysis of our organization. Continue encouraging the participation of the women in the biotechnological, medical, pharmaceutical industry, and in the tourism sector, according to the priority which this sector has within the country's development strategy. And also continue to contribute to the necessary growth of the participation of women in rural environments, especially young women in the agricultural sector. Also, we need to work to increase the incorporation of women in the occupational category of the working class, starting from the diagnosis made by each municipality, hold events for working women in different sectors, and use methods to discover their motivations, aspirations, interests, encouraging the most positive attitudes and outcomes. Design a specific program to provide new job skills for women and for those seeking employment for the first time. This is a very important point. Make a study of the participation of self-employed women in order to provide them with better attention, inspection, and organization. Next, I will show you some photographs that I take of women involved in the different fields in my country, in different economic sectors. As you can see here is a woman in the agricultural sector as a teacher in a group session. Here is a woman working in the army, the Cuban army, a woman in the sports, a seller of juice in the streets, agricultural sector, a housewife, a hairdresser, beauty parlor, at the production process of cooking in a factory, here a florist, a woman working in a pharmacy, a dependent at a cafeteria, a computer technician, a woman reading a magazine in the streets, a Cuban. A math teacher in the school, a worker at the container area, a police woman, an electric engineer woman in a laboratory, a microbiologist, a cleaner of the streets, a taxi driver, a shoemaker, or a bag maker too, a woman with a child, her child, our prime ballet dancer, Alicia Alonso, general director of the National Ballet of Cuba, prime ballet dancer, Bianca Valdez, the first, a producer of tobacco at the Hotel National Hotel in Cuba, a woman meeting of the Cuban Woman Federation with coffee production women. This activity is very usual that the Cuban Woman Federation do these activities with the producer. This is me at an international training in India in a cluster development executive program. This is in Moscow, celebrating the International Women's Day with my mom. And this is some pictures of Cuba that I took, the Cathedral of Havana, the Theater Garcia Lorca, a very famous theater in Cuba, the National Hotel located in the center of Havana. You can see a panoramic view of the hotel, the Capitol, University of Havana, the San Pedro de la Roca Castle in Santiago de Cuba, a Cuban province, the Morro Castle in Havana Bay, also another view of the Morro Castle, the Statue of Neptune in Havana Bay, a canyon in the Morro Castle during the long period of the Spanish colonialism, Havana City from Morro Castle, the old square of Old Havana, the panoramic view also with Old Havana, a font, the Malecón of Havana, a typical Cuban landscape, the Moncada building, and Havanilla Lake, a very famous tourist place, and Pinar del Río province, and Varadero Beach, one of the most important tourist place beach known of around all the world. Thank you. Thank you so much.